I feel impelled to speak today in a language that, in a sense, is new. One which I, who have spent so much of my life in the military profession, would have preferred never to use. That new language is the language of atomic warfare. The atomic age has moved forward at such a pace that every citizen of the world should have some comprehension, at least in comparative terms, of the extent of this development, of the utmost significance to every one of us. Clearly, if the peoples of the world are to conduct an intelligent search for peace, they must be armed with the significant facts of today's existence.
Before the first blast, mic shot of Operation Island. 59 minutes now to be exact. We've been here since daybreak. Let we talk last night during the early morning hours. As you can imagine, feeling is running pretty high about now, and there's reason for it. If everything goes according to plan, we'll soon see the largest explosion ever set off on the face of the Earth. That is, the largest that we know of. In the time between now and HR, I'd like to show you around, if I may, and introduce you to some of the people connected with this operation. And in general, piece together the events which have brought us to this point. To start off, I'd like to show you something over here. You realize there are many miles of ocean between us and any Weetok atoll. To know what's going on back at the atoll, these antennas are receiving televised signals and are giving our men here a second-by-second account of what's happening on Shot Island. The television receivers are in here, in the control room.
Well, this is it. This is the control room. I'd like to have you meet Mr. Stan Burriss, the commander of the scientific task group.
Oh, Stan, I wonder if you could tell us something about the operations that go on in this room.
Sure, I'd be glad to. The screens you see in front of you enable us to monitor the timing of firing system. If you look close, you'll see that it is now 55 minutes before HR. As time clicks off, more and more lights come into operation. This is the 1 minute light, 30 second, 15, 5, 1, through firing. This diagram will give you a general idea of the whole setup. Data from the sequence timer is piped over to a display panel.
This kind of display panel is new to atomic test work because of the large number of remote control and metering problems encountered in this operation. For one thing, the master timing and metering apparatus is located next door to the shot cab rather than being placed some 20 miles away on Parry Island as is usually done. This close view is possible, of course, because the lens of a television camera rather than human eyes is watching events.
So that's the flow. From timer on through to display panel, picked up by a television camera and relayed on out to the Estes. A very ingenious arrangement. But what happens if you have to stop the firing mechanism, or can you stop it?
We can stop it all right if we have to. We have a radio link direct to the firing panel in the shot cab. If we have to stop the shot, we simply push this button.
Just a simple flip of the wrist, huh?
That's right. But a lot of work goes down the drain. You understand, we don't want to stop this thing unless it's absolutely essential.
No, I can understand that. Say, I was out on deck when you fellas returned. Well, that is, when the firing party returned. What happened out there on Shot Island?
If you'll excuse me, I suggest you talk to Colonel Lunger about that. I have a timing signal coming up.
All right. So then, Dick, the firing party's big job is to see to last-minute details of arming and firing and to make sure that the Shot Island is secure.
That's the broad brush of it, yes.
I have been a member of firing parties before, but this was different somehow. A man standing, as I stood, on the outside of the building housing the mic device, couldn't help but feel, to sense the importance of this moment. Inside, a handful of men were making a final check, were arming a device which could be the key to a new era in atomic weaponry. I don't know just how the others felt, but I felt small when I thought of the experiment being readied inside. This one test could take us out of the realm of kilotons into the fantastic world of megatons. And then, at H minus 6 hours, the job was finished. The mic device was on its own and ready. We made the run from Shot Island down to the anchorage of the Estes off Parry in a fast pressure. Soon after, the Estes made way through the deep entrance between Parry and Japtan Islands, out to a point 10 miles southeast of Parry, the rendezvous area of the task force ships.
We finished our job at the cab, came over the side, and here we are.
Not long ago at Los Alamos, I was talking to Dr. Alvin C. Graves, head of the test division there. He's on board now in Flag Plot as the scientific deputy to the task force commander. He's one of the men who can tell us about the thinking behind this operation.
The Shot Island is about over there?
That's right. It's generally north and west of us. For the past half hour, the ship has been headed directly toward the Shot Island, and will continue to do so until shot time.
You know, there's one thing I can't quite put together. That's this business of success or failure. I've heard there's a 50% chance of its failing. Now, this low margin of success wasn't true on the other shots, was it?
No, it wasn't.
Let me try out the Atlas chair.
Sure.
Up until this operation, that is, from about 1945 through 1951, the chance of failure has never been more than about 10%. In Crossroads, Sandstone, and Greenhouse, we had great confidence in the operation succeeding. We recognized the change in philosophy, however, when Dr. Bradbury spoke to a group of us at Los Alamos.
Gentlemen, up to now, the laboratory has had sufficient time to compile information and revise weapon design before a field test of a weapon. As of now, the situation has changed. We must take risks, calculated risks, it is true, but risks nevertheless. According to the presidential directive, we must ascertain if a hydrogen bomb is feasible and do this in the highest possible speed. Here is what I think we must do. We must set up a special staff under Dr. Marshall Holloway, reporting directly to my office. He will receive from the theoretical division the theoretical designs of such a system, have them fabricated, and shipped to NOE dock. There, they'll be taken by Dr. Graves and J Division and tested. it must be recognized that we're taking great chances. A great gamble, but a gamble, while there's a possibility of failure, nevertheless there's a possibility of great gains. Energy talk will become our theoretical laboratory rather than a proving ground.
And that's the way it is today. We're taking a gamble.
I see that now. But then the uneasy state of the world puts everything on a gambling basis, I guess.
Yes, but not as much of a gamble as you might think. Take that man over there. He and his company have put a great deal of thought into the engineering and design of Mike. Well, see you later.
So long, Doctor, and thanks a lot. Well, so far, we've pieced together quite a bit of this operation. I don't believe you've ever had a good look at our key test islands.
The test islands for Mike are located at the top, or the northern sector, of Eniwetok Atoll. Some 25 miles from Perry and Eniwetok, the two base islands of this atoll proving grounds. There are three main islands making up the test site. These are Alugilab, Teeter, and Bogan. In the early months, Alugilab was just another small, naked island of the atoll. But by midsummer, it began to look like the thing it was selected for, a shot island. Actually, the cab, so-called because it houses the weapon, is not a cab at all, but a building set flush to the ground. It has all the earmarks of a common workshed, but in reality is a laboratory building set on a Pacific atoll. This, as you have probably gathered, is joint operations. All atomic test operations in the Pacific so far have been run under a joint task force kind of setup. Operation Ivy is using the same organizational structure as Greenhouse. Four task groups: Scientific, Army, Navy, and Air Force. Members of these groups are here now, sifting and coordinating the many details of this joint operation and passing key information top sides to the command level. The Army is...
Conway 2, working cottage radar contact Scott.
The Army is the executive agent on this operation, just as the Air Force was on Greenhouse and the Navy on Crossroads before that. At this point in our story, it's necessary to understand the effort behind the collecting of measurement data. Well, what good is a test unless we can learn, can profit from the experience? Highly specialized, sometimes costly instruments help scientists bring home this vital data. An outstanding example of such specialization is the use of a helium atmosphere box by the Naval Research Laboratory. The plywood tube, looking like a train of boxcars, runs from the shot island across the causeways to a detection station on Bogan, a distance of nearly 2 miles. In addition to the diagnostic kind of measurement, many studies are being run on the effects expected from a high-order detonation. These projects are being conducted jointly by the AEC and the Department of Defense. As always, there are many questions to be answered. Classical, routine questions, and special, pertinent questions pertaining to the hydrogen device, Mike. The story of heat or thermal radiation needs continued study. The ever-interesting history of neutrons will be recorded. What amounts of external neutrons are present? And what is their energy distribution? Because of the expected size of the shot, the fallout problem is being extensively analyzed.
H minus 5 minutes. The shock wave will not arrive for several minutes after zero time. Keep firm footing until after the wave passes.
Our latest obtained upper wind sounding from Eniwetok.
You've been here before, flag block.
Shows distinctly that in the
That's General Clarkson, the task force commander, and General Wolf, chief of staff. The scientific deputy, Dr. Graves, you've already met.
Followed by again west.
Captain Ball is deputy for naval operations, and General Wise, deputy for the Air Force. As you've gathered, a weather briefing is taking place. I should say another weather briefing. You've probably heard many times before how important the weather picture is in an atomic test operation. Weather can make or break a test shot. That's why you want to know up to the last moment just how you stand with the elements.
I feel that this is about the solid forecast.
The problem this time is especially acute because this entire area of the Pacific is subject to radiological fallout. And this area is inhabited by some 20,000 people, plus, of course, the ships of this task force. That's why the RadSafe officer works hand in glove with the weather officer. Oh, by the way, to help you understand this problem, these weathermen are covering an area larger than the United States with 10 weather aircraft and 11 fixed weather stations. To put it mildly, that's quite a territory to cover. Let's listen in, shall we?